Hello everyone, how are you today? I am Muhammad Amir Siddique, international journalist around the world, people know me. Today I am here in Vienna, Austria. OPEC Development Forum organized today. It's a very big conference here. The large number of ministers, diplomats, also ambassadors attend that conference. Let's go to check how many people are there and how is that conference. My video starts now. Now second session start. Let's go to check how many people attend that second session.
Since 2023, very warm. Thank you very much, and thank you for OPEC Fund, for international development, for organizing this very important forum. I believe, you know, thank you for that very good question, and the previous speakers have really elaborated a lot on the different challenges that are being faced. I want to discuss a few of them, especially in the aftermath of COVID-19, mostly the socio-economic challenges that the countries of the South are grappling with, but also the financial aspects. And the development finance was quite discussed previously. This is extremely important. This is very much what the member states that have been expressing recently during our high-level committee on South-South cooperation. And it's very much at the heart of the different reports that we have been analyzing and putting forward. So basically, socioeconomic implications, gender disparities has been widening, the impacts of climate change, because this has to do with the resilience of the countries to address them. After the pandemic, the question of health resilience is a key element, how to build resilience institutionally in preparation for any forthcoming pandemic or any other disasters of that scale. But also what's important is also to look at the most affected groups and where are the entry points for the opportunities? What is it there to leverage, right? The power of the youth is something that we need to think about in the countries of the South. Regional collaboration, of course, integration, institutional strengthening has been coming up as a key area of support, and the engagement of civil society, private sector, development banks have been more and more needed, not only in terms of financial support and contribution, but also in terms of bringing innovation to the table, bringing science, technology, and all these elements that are extremely important. So this is in a nutshell. And we as an office, we're trying to see how we can reinforce the establishment of those monitoring platforms, building capacities, but also to convey the voices of the South and bringing them to the table. That's the point here.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Dima. That was very, very good and very comprehensive. Dima mentioned the different entry points of opportunities. She mentioned also the new ways of thinking, and I think that's the perfect opportunity to very briefly speak about the new roadmap, the new strategy of the roadmap group, and how to efficiently translate the sustainable development policies into a very concrete action. And maybe if you look at that from a regional collaboration perspective.
Thank you, Andreas. You said that you were a very blunt professor. Let me be very blunt, Vice President of the Eastern of Africa for the World Bank. We are putting lots of money into all of these issues, but we are nowhere near what is needed. This is why when we talk about this evolutionary mandate that the body is looking at right now, when the new president of the World Bank, Algeria, is talking about his mission statement, that is fighting poverty with very much figurative and affirmative action, and at the same time fighting it within the difficult planet. When we put that together, what are we looking at? And I'm looking at, if I may, my region, the Middle East and North Africa. Big challenge here. By 2050, we'll be looking at 300 million young people not able to go to the job market in the Middle East and North Africa. 300 million young people, which is more or less the population of the Middle East and North Africa today. These young people will not find a job in the public sector. They will only find a job in the private sector, and the private sector in our region is not developed. We are not putting together the platform that would allow for more private enterprise to thrive. This is something that is really, really important by all of us. When you look at this money crisis that you mentioned, you're absolutely right. There is a money crisis right now, but didn't stop today. It's been there for quite some time. And it's been exacerbated by a cascade of shocks that came and that really shook up the whole world. And frankly, the situation with the war on Ukraine started, we found ourselves in a situation where we were running to find something, you know, to help our people. Now, we have situations related to climate. We have desertification in our region. We have coastal erosion in our region. We have water scarcity in our region. Are we doing enough? I'm not sure we're doing enough. Not because we don't want to do enough, but because, one, there is, frankly, I believe, not enough realization from our policymaker that things have to move fast. Second, because money is not there, not as much as we should have. And this is where, you know, scaling up, putting more money into these agendas is very important. Let me finish with one word. The World Bank this year delivered more than $72 billion in development, out of which $32 billion for climate. The Middle East and Africa region alone delivered more than $6.5 billion for the region, out of which 38% for climate. So we are there, but you know what? The delta between where we are and what is needed is extremely, extremely wide. One last word, because I would be remiss if I don't thank Abraham and his team for having done an amazing job at putting this together and to allow me to put all of these issues in provocative way.
Brilliant, thank you so much. That was exactly what I was looking for. So the delta is $2. New entrepreneurship, climate, all stuff, food insecurity, and a lack of capacity, a lack of financial capacity. I mean, there's one of the key points you have to ask for. But it's the perfect question, Mr. Sam, because the question I have to you is, I mean, how can MEBs such as AEB promote the additional, the catalytic funding facilities in this context? How can you crowd in, how can you mobilize all of the innovative solutions to exactly come to a point where we can find a solution, try to find solutions at the end?
Thank you very much. And a lot of comments are being thrown down here, and I just wanted to thank you for being here. You know, climate, sustainability, looking for solutions, these are all within the crosshairs that we're looking at. So one of the things that we're trying to do with ABB is to focus on sustainability, looking at climate in Asia and the Pacific. And what we have in place right now, we have climate targets of about 100 million we're supposed to be providing from our own resources between 2019 and 2030. Of that, 12 billion is to come from the private sector, which I look after in the Asia and Pacific, and then to mobilize an additional 18 to 30 million. So those are some really big numbers, and I think that you can't do that unless you have partnerships. And I think that that's one of the keys that, you know, we're really looking for across our development partners here, our private sector partners. And, you know, we have many topics that we've been trying to discuss about that, not only now, but through, it's a very active week, you know, if I go before summer, many of these discussions are taking place. But how can we scale on climate? How can we scale on gender? How can we scale on all these different things? And I think that, you know, providing opportunities, working together, providing solutions, creating platforms,
mean, you have a PhD in economics, so I can't ask you other smart questions as well, which means, like, can you somehow elaborate, like, what are the main factors which makes regional cooperation successful?
Thank you. Central America is actually, as the matter of the very similar. So, in a way, having regional coordination makes a lot of sense. But the example I want to mention here is in the pandemic, countries shut down, there was no flights, and the countries were shutting down, and how do you provide for income and for people who stay at home? So, I came out with a $4 billion program that included the sector, public sector, and we called friends, and actually, it's okay here because the OPEC Fund Development Forum, those friends came from really far away. They came to help, and we also have help from countries in Asia, Korea, Taiwan, in the US, the USCFC. Even so to create this partnership that actually involves central governments, local governments, private sector. But what I wanted to kind of focus is that, if you think about migration, poverty, small and medium enterprise, gender, inclusion, these are problems that so having the same approach to the same issues, regardless of the country, it actually makes sense and it's very fast. So we actually came back with a second package, the after-pandemic stimulus package, and that was pretty strong on helping the MSMEs, the medium small enterprises. And most of these businesses were led by women, young, and we use all tricks, we use an all guarantee fund free of charge to these individuals we didn't have as a spread. So the program was so successful that we draw some lessons. And now we have another program with a retirement fund that actually does exactly the same, but was for MSMEs who are in the right part of Central America. So it's for climate oriented investments. For agricultural sector, for a group of people that tend to migrate very fast. And so we do have a good idea to get partners. So beyond the Internet Fund, UFDFC and other donors to actually connect these partners. So I guess to get to your question, I think there are two things that are very important. For me, not very to work, your hands dirty, your feet on the ground, so I think bags are very important. But we are there, and we live there, so it's not like we take the first plane and pick up the war bag. So, taking the plane going back to Washington is not very easy. So I said, but when you live in the country, maybe you better solve the problem because you live there. So, in that sense, regional banks are a fantastic partner for large institutions that have more challenges getting down to the ground to the people. Meaningful impact. The last thing I want to say, because I know about what I talk too much, is we actually take beneficiaries. When we shared this information with the donors, they were so impacted. A woman said, my small business was shut down because of the pandemic because of this first loan that I had, the guarantee fund. I managed to rehire my old staff. There was one of the new married, I saw she did well. But also, she said, I didn't mind you because of this law. So that tells you that some good ideas actually bring some others, and then that big your goal for other companies to join in. So, with that said, I think people banks are a fantastic partner to this project.
Excellent example. I think the three key takeaways for me are number one, around beneficiaries for the impact, so it's youth entrepreneurs, women entrepreneurs, MSMEs. The second one was the innovative financing solutions, how can we crowd in other institutions? And the third one, of course, was
if you look at the geographic region in Thailand, Thailand is run by a large community. If you look at the per capita, Thailand, at the moment we have $7,000 per capita income, while we have 1,100 and can we have 1,500 and the last 2,500. So the difference between of development level between Thailand and surrounding countries are much different. So we have already created the asset free area, which is called AFTA. So we bring down all the Thailand barrier, all the transferization, and also we have financial representations between all the soft banks in place, but the development level between countries is different. So they create from MENA, our office in 2005. The aim is to help promote investment in these three, four countries to build up the level of development in the city. So we provide loans, concession loans, as ADB and all that. In the beginning, we get some help from ADBs and also China to set up our office 15 years ago. And now that we collaborate more and more, we have annual meeting with ADB and all other development partners like JICA and Korea and even China. And for the first few projects, one of the very important projects was a art training project, a global project creating Thailand, Laos, and then to China. It was to be financed by ADB and Thailand and China government to that global project. Because at the beginning, our funding was really good, so we need partners to help funding this global project. And we learned a lot of experience from ADB and other development partners. And so recently, we just have a project called the steadfast project in the watershed point in cross-border between Thailand and Libya. We find the first project by ourselves through our government budget and also a raising fund from the market. But also, particularly phase two, we get funding from JICA to work on some competitive projects, which means that the collaboration between the two other agencies is important and to scale up the project size for our respective.
Excellent. Thank you very much. And I think this is a crucial point that the collaboration between the different DFIs and the National Development Banks, maybe, and the MDBs, but also other partners being in there. And I mean, we have seen so many difficulties in the past regarding collaboration. But I think they see so much progress now, how people work together and think about the right impact. We covered a couple of different elements of infrastructure, gender, youth, entrepreneurship, etc. Let's use 4 or 5 minutes, maybe 1 minute each per panelist on climate and SDGs, because also the minister, Vanya, she mentioned, of course, came in COP27. We are on our way to COP28 at Lima. And we always talk about net zero, and I know that because I'm having both the creation of a net zero export credit topic agency aligned at UNFI together with our friends at Oxford. But I mean, the just transition is not about the high industrial countries. The just transition is what the developing countries need, what the NDCs need. How can they clearly achieve that at COP28?
Interesting.
60 seconds.
Well, obviously, I mean, there is a need for them to have an equal seat at the table and to be able to, you know, also on an evidence-based approach express the need of their own countries. Hence, the intensive need, if you will, of capacity building for negotiation for the countries. But also to bring forward the impact on how they are impacted and how much a just transition is needed, an inclusive one that takes into account the needs of the countries, not only to mitigate but also to adapt. I know that in the previous panel the adaptation element was mentioned. This is extremely important. Now the access to finance is also another extremely important one. Hence, the attention now is leading to COP28 on the operationalization of the loss and damage fund, right? The accessibility and the abilities of the countries to do it and to be able to actually operationalize it quickly on the ground. We have seen also how much the recovery from the damage is taking a lot of time. The recent floods that happened in Pakistan, which by the way was a show of solidarity from the countries. including a lot of groups present here, to support Pakistan to recover from the floods. However, there is still a lot to do. You know, how can Pakistan adapt for, God forbid, any disaster that will come? That's another question. So engagement and just transition, inclusion, adaptation, easy access to finance, and hence the loss of the hedge fund will be hopefully an easier mechanism for the practice.
Thank you very much. Thanks for the excellent response. Inclusion, engagement, access to finance, period. What can the roadmap do for that?
Because I mentioned earlier, we have the multilateral president who is very, very far away from what is needed. I believe that for the developing countries, put it that way, there is a need to really scale up their engagement and their negotiation capacity. We don't want to be in a catch-up mode to where we have been in many other agendas, whether it is off the sea, whether in other places. We need to be out there.
Together.
you know, the other, I think, a thing that I'd like to mention is trade finance. Trade finance and different types of instruments. I think trade finance and trading with flows, and again, providing guarantees and certainties within the market, I think that creates the economic wheels, continues to focus on those areas of need in our countries and regions. Lots of different things, partnerships, working together, putting up solutions to actually create these levels of certainty in the price of
things. Certainty of price of needs. Thank you. That's, I think, a very good point, Doctor. And what is maybe the most interesting example of regional collaboration, but also innovative solutions people should want you when they're able to catch you during the lunch break? What would be your advice?
Well, I think the main partnership that I think now is to work with the private sector, and not only with the hot water, it's already invented. So, Kuwait, for example, I have a big brother who will buy and said, well, have more buy very well, so they break the event. So, we are doing that at Kuwait, we have a group of people in Fürstengasse and Fürstengasse, thank you. And so, the whole idea of empowering the private sector will be finance the budget of my government, which is a few. And we have the ability to increase borders, we have green bonds, social bonds. So, in a way, doing what we are doing a little bit of consultation, but for some limitation, capital, or structure, cannot do this in America. So, in a way, I think the key word for me is to bring the market sector, use what has been used by other institutions, and get faster and sooner as you can.
Because temperatures are either higher or the crops are not yielding. trust in him. I said, she told me, and she said, we'll enjoy your time in Vienna. For those of you who are from Arabia, who were raised for many generations, about praising Vienna for Layan Kunz, which are basically the lights of presence. So these present lights, if you are concerned about SDGs and climate agenda, have four questions posed to me. Have governments reaction? How do we have a meaningful approach towards climate change and SDGs? How do we link to regional allies and local allies? And how can we increase mobilization of finance? So, the Honourable Minister of Frontier and Development in the room, with his many capacities, including leading the world for the development of the sea, the excellencies of the Minister of Finance from Iraq, and the many excellencies here. Well, let me just start on the stand of pleasant news. These are the SDGs for the reminder. We are beyond a few days of halfway reaching or not reaching the SDGs. Well, if I'm taking the recommendations of my good daughter seriously, the present times in Vienna, we shouldn't be worried. We shouldn't be worried about the attack to achieve the SDGs. Climate action is of no concern. MDBs are qualified to do more. Finance is there adequately. And with a good recommendation from our excellent moderator, one wants us to move far, we are moving fast at the same time. This is all illusions, what I just said now. This is all illusions. Surely, with the elusive imagination by being in Vienna. But the reality is, as mentioned by the Secretary General of the UN, only less than 15% of the SDGs are being achieved. Less than 15% on the targets that have indicators. 17 goals, 169 targets, we have over 230 data sets, indicators for that, for those who have data for 140 of them, only 15% or less are being achieved. 50% are off track or severely off track. And the rest, and we are suffering from regression from the 2015 or new terms, including poverty and malnutrition. So, well, going far, going fast, and actually let me just be very simply blunt here. My good friend Fernando Pals mentioned the evolution roadmap of the multilateral development banks. This is a roadmap to push the multilateral development finance system into the relevance. It's encouraging a slow pace towards achieving the required capital requirements. It is not really helping us in the developing world to have a solution for what we are suffering from today on the fact that development finance and climate finance are insufficient, inefficient, and unfair. We owe it to the generation of my only daughter to tell the truth that we need to need more capital. There are limits to do more with less. There are limits to do more with the same. The multilateral development bank system needs to be funded adequately and need to be supported efficiently, and we need to have a completely different model. I'm saying that because in a few months, as we know, COP28 will be hosted at the United Arab Emirates. Before that, we have summits starting the next hours in Paris. Then we have another summit in Kenya, and then three summits at the margins of our world. If we're going to lose all of these summits, and we have the annual meetings of the World Bank and IMF in Marrakesh, if I'm missing all of these opportunities, we're going to be in more trouble than what we are in today. SDGs are not on track. Climate finance is not adequate. Climate action is required. All eyes are on COP28 in the United Arab Emirates, and the team there are working hard in areas related to finance, technology, behavioral change, operationalizing. realizing our plans. Simply, and it's not because of lack of capital, because we have seen capital mobilized. We need it like what we saw in the big banks in the US and Europe. But when it comes to one bank and the likes, they are victims of geopolitical tensions. It is not about lack of capital. It's basically geopolitical tensions that are not allowing these institutions to get their adequate funding. And if we are facing a ceiling of finance, if your country called Kenya, Egypt, Ghana, or Cambodia, these are basically because these institutions are not adequate in finance. I'm not saying going to these summits, many of them are not being involved, especially if I'm allowed to be one or two of them after what I'm saying now, with high expectations, with managed expectations. But the hope would be very much on these. There is a recommendation coming from the Secretary General of the UN. We need to reduce debt. Significantly, 50 countries are suffering from a variety of debt challenges and crises. 50 countries of the low income and developing economies. The debt service are needing from education, from health, and from the rest of the essential infrastructure. We have as well the Bridgetown 2.0 initiative that has 6 points attached to it to achieve better systems of finance. This is going to be discussed in Paris. I think it will be meeting that rescheduling and that release 500 million to be provided to ODA to support the NDBs, $1.5 trillion to be leveraged by NDBs, and then consider world governance and world trade. Good luck with that. Whatever that happens, we are actively working at the regional level, and I'm happy that the United Arab Emirates is taking the lead from Egypt, focusing on implementation and areas related to solutions. And now, on the regional goals, there are no goals, so it's basically about practical consideration of what we can be doing. So we worked hard for a few months because of those who believe that you have the money, but you don't really have investable or bankable projects. They are not. We proved them wrong. We worked hard as climate champions, now the climate system, Basada Mubarak, following up on that from the UAE, worked hard with BCG, with the recent development commissions, and we have more than 200 investable projects covering all areas of climate finance and development finance. And these are basically being prepared across the 5 regions of the UN system, and they are available. You can consult Google now for assets to flows and the pipeline of investable projects. And this is the funnel that we came from 470 plus applications. We were shortlisted by 108 to 108, and now we are working on financing them. By the time we're meeting in the way, inshallah, we have more than anticipated than 7 projects as examples, but we have at least 15 projects covering mitigation, adaptation, and beyond, with the cooperation of many of the MPDs and many of the investment banks. The other hope is coming from not visualization, but from localization. Again, it's an issue of having green and smart projects going forward. And we did that through a big competition, and I intend to please emulate this example, because when we asked about climate, we actually see great response from the field. See that the experts are just talking to each other in silence. So what we try to do is basically to have this big competition. And through that competition that had more than 6,000 submissions, we had lists of projects across the 27 governance regions with 6 categories, including youth-owned projects, women-managed projects, and many of the projects at the data science level. And we have them, we keep winning projects, and we're doing that for the second year, and the winners will be with us in Dubai. Finally, and just to remind you of the controversy of what I just said, especially I have only less than 9 seconds left. 3 big questions, your answers to them should be known. Climate finance is different from development finance. This is waste of time. Climate finance is about energy, which is SDG 7. Climate finance is about water, which is SDG 6. If you do it well, this is going to be dealing with poverty and inequality. then there's a waste of time to be in that article around based on the views, will be views about that. We said, well, before putting our money, we need to make sure that these banks are efficient. Right? They are trying to be efficient. Improve their operations. Actually, we can accept that if you are a single member of these multilateral development banks. This is basically very much complicating the world of your staff. This is dishonoring and disrespecting the efficient staff in your institutions. This is admitting that you are not really doing the best out of the capital that you have. Actually, you can have efficient banks, what we need. Definitely we need better banks. Definitely we need bigger banks. Look at your balance sheet compared to them if you are in existence for 40 years, many things are. The case of the World Bank, its balance sheet today is 20% of what it used to be back in 1970. So we cannot really prevent ourselves from having capital increase immediately. I was involved in the last capital increase of the World Bank in 2015. If you have a political agreement now, it will take you anything between 3 to 5 years in order to have this capital increase. Actually, until this moment, the Lima agreement to capital increase, you don't have full subscription. So, if you need to fix climate, and then if you want to advance the development finance agenda, you need to work hard with the private sector that needs to be leveraged, as mentioned in the previous panel. You can't leverage the private sector, you can't reduce the private sector kind of operations if you are less and less of relevance in the market. So, having said that, I wish you all the best. What I mean we need to have is bigger investments in human capital, infrastructure, and more resilience for the next generation to have better prospects of development. Thank you so much.
Conversation and dialogue on sustainable food systems.
Starting with His Excellency, Dr. Siddique, who is the Director General of
Absolutely. Thank you very much, Dr. Sarkani. I think the key takeaway there is the importance of global food systems, but also the fact that national food systems are a key critical element to national security. But I think another element that we need to talk about and moving to Algeria, so-called, is the element of trade finance. You know, trade finance is viewed as the lifeblood of food supplies, given the importance of supply chains. But as we've witnessed, of course, over the last few years, that this is, you know, subject to disruptions from conflict, from the pandemic, or whatever it is. From your perspective, what is it we can do to improve the resilience of trade finance going forward?
Thank you. Thank you very much. Actually, I'd like to thank you for actually the kind invitation and being really a part of this very honest gathering here today in Vienna. You know, we've spoke a lot about really what is the issues with climate change and agriculture issues for the last 2 to 3 years, food security. We've been talking a lot about this very important topics, you know, without really seeing much, as Dr. Mahmoud said, much advances in the way we are really trying to reach our results. I remember when I first joined the development banking 14 years back, I remember the complexity of these issues were totally different, dealing with 57 member countries, mainly 2/3 of them on the least developed countries, and we were not so much, we have not seen really much of this complexity. IDB group, as IDB of course was maybe the first MDB to really have a devoted trade finance department. You know, at that time people were questioning actually why we are doing trade finance. Many did not recognize that trade finance at that time was the engine of growth. But in fact, nowadays it became very evident that this is really the way to, as they say this morning also, to keep the flow going. In years after getting so much experience, we felt that also we have to become resilient as an institution by being able actually to develop and produce solutions for member countries. As they say, maybe the funding is not the end of the solution. Actually, the funding is part of the solution. That's why we have very much now more of an integrated, you know, solutions that sometimes based on technology and based on innovation, just to support member countries. We've started really to make sure that ITFC can, and ICD as well, can always provide, you know, the financing to all member countries. Many issues under our solutions are addressed, you know, when we face, for example, climate change, when we face food security issues. Our really main objective is actually to help member countries understand that there are so many issues in terms of what was said, in terms of policies, in terms of regulations, but also helping this very particular point on the food security is to help member countries diversify the source actually of their food supplies. We actually have the largest portfolio in ITFC actually devoted for energy and food supplies. And almost like $11 billion was devoted for this topic. We were trying to help countries to diversify, as I said, because some people say we are paying for globalization. We are trying to see how a continent like Africa today can have an added value by really having to go one step, you know, without really exporting raw material to others and bring it back again to the country with no added value. We're trying to help that. We're trying also to help now with the climate, climate change, issues, to have what we call the climate resilient crops, like the heat-resilient wheat, farming like in Ethiopia and others who have made a very successful stories. We try to promote also sustainable, farming practices by helping small farmers as well as large farmers in member countries. Take coffee, for example, in Indonesia. We have tried to really bring to them the best practices for them to really improve the yield of their land and become more resilient. I think that's what we are really,
Thank you very much. I believe that we cannot talk about food security in Africa without thinking about small farmers. And we cannot also talk about any economic development in Africa without talking about micro, small and large enterprises. And this is why Badea, in its strategy Badea 2030, has retained micro, small and large enterprises as one of the main pillars of strategy, but also agricultural value chain and infrastructure as a third pillar. So you see that all these pillars are intertwined, and we cannot develop a climate resilient agriculture without developing resilient infrastructure. And Badea has a long track record over more than 40 decades implementing successful projects which make it easier for small farmers in remote areas in Africa to be able to grow their crops, but also to take them to market. What we have learned from this experience is what has been highlighted by Shepard and Maslow this morning regarding the need for partnership. So not a single institution can alone be able to achieve any success in any endeavor without other partners. We also learned from our experience that we need to work with all the stakeholders and to adopt a holistic approach. Otherwise, we will not be able to continue to work in silos. That way, we will not be able to enable any institution to deliver this development money. This is why we believe that the integrated approach is quite critical. We are working with Agfam, for instance. Dr. Basel is here. We are working with them on an integrated approach to bring microfinance, microinsurance, seed, quality seeds, extension services, education, and many other players to work together and to provide integrated solution for the small farmers.
Thank you so much, Dr. That's very, very interesting. And just bringing the conversation around to climate, there's of course climate at the moment and doing particularly when it comes to food security. Now, Mr. Shroff, you speak a lot about emissions as they relate to agriculture and the agricultural sector. Given global decarbonization efforts, what more can we do and how can we reduce emissions specific to the food sector?
Thank you very much. We are honored to be here and really represent the private sector. There's so much 10% reduction is actually more than what the UN requires. That's 2.5% reduction. And are we rewarding the food system enough? Are we rewarding the center stage that is around enough to really to make an effort towards decarbonizing the world?
Excellent. Thank you. And I'll just move to Dr. Da. In 30 seconds or less, the African continental free trade area is an important initiative. It's meant to improve our supply chains. How is Badiana engaging in this?
This is a very important development in Africa. And Badiana has immediately launched what we call the Africa Trade Facility, which is meant to support cross-border trade among African countries. And with a special focus on food security, fertilizer, and also crops. And more important in the market is funding integration, regional integration project, including bridges, roads, linking landlocked country with coastal areas, linking rural areas with urban areas. And the bank also is supporting energy infrastructure, interconnection among African countries, among many, many, many other infrastructures.
Absolutely, thank you. And coming finally to close the session with Gene Sobo, and we ask you to take off your ICFC hats for 30 seconds and put on the acting CEO ICD act. How can we mobilize the market?
Thank you very much. Allow me to follow up Dr. Siddique for 1 second. Because he has mentioned really this excellent synergy that we are building in Africa through this very excellent program, but also on the Arab Africa Trade Bridge. This is the EU, this is the largest program with the largest in partners, the US, of all Africa, so far, with Badia, with others. We are trying to make the best out of that. We will be, inshallah, announcing very soon this Arab Africa Trade Bridge food security program. This is something else other than the IDB 10.5 billion program that was announced last year. ICD is, of course, a very active member in the group. And what makes IDB group unique is that the diversity of products that we really offer. And this is why we are really trying to build internal synergy so that the impact of the group financing can be greater and greater in member countries. ICD, of course, is really the arm to support the private sector through really providing financing to the private sector's strategic, strategic projects, especially in the area of storage, in the area of really supporting countries, programs. We also have this promoting investment, activities. We have been providing capacity building as well in ICD by providing also the green finance, also school for member countries to be able to keep up with this world direction. We also have the private, what we call private sector advisory services. That is very important when we provide advisory to the companies. In addition to that, through equity and through term financing, we are actually participating in agri-tech and agribusiness companies that is spread all over the African continent and also other member countries. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. And on that fascinating note, we've come to the end of this panel. We've gotten some very interesting insights. We've heard about how we need to make social systems more sustainable. We heard about the link between national systems and food security and actually country security. We heard about the need to provide climate risk insurance to smallholder farmers. And we've heard about fascinating work about the African continental free trade zone. So, thank you for listening and thank you to the distinguished panelists. If you could please give them a round of applause for them.
Let's actually start thinking about ways in which we can fix. set of challenges that are primarily dealing with the impacts of climate change and gaining energy security. They have nothing to do with generating climate emissions. And that's true for most of our developing member countries. We have a few that are higher numbers, but most of our countries have generated very little in terms of GHG emissions, but are feeling the impacts of climate change in a major way already. And so we need to be looking at a range of financing mechanisms that meet those conditions at the country level and at the either adaptation or mitigation level. The second thing I think we have to be aware of is that it's not an either or. We have to be focused on scaling up decarbonization in a major way. We have to accelerate investments in decarbonization in every country. Otherwise, we're going to end up spending all of our money in the future on dealing with the impacts of climate change. So, but at the same time, the impacts of climate change are already here. The Pakistan floods last year affected 33 million people, cost the country $15 billion, and many of those poor households are still, they'll suffer for years. That's only going to increase in frequency and intensity. So we're going to be dealing with the impacts of climate change and trying to find ways of paying for that for a long time. The range of mechanisms that we're looking at in ADB are on the decarbonization side, I'm sure we'll talk about this later, are how do you go to scale with closing coal-fired power plants in particular and increasing investments in renewable energy and recovery. On the broader climate agenda, we just approved and launched a what we call an innovative financing facility for climate and Asia Pacific last month, at our annual meeting last month. And this is a very interesting approach whereby contributors, mainly donor governments, provide a guarantee to ADB, and we use that guarantee to carve out part of our existing loan portfolio, sovereign loan portfolio. These are very low-risk loans, which we have less than 1% default on those kind of loans. By carving them out, for every dollar that we get in guarantee, we're able to mobilize $4 billion in climate finance. So this is the first time that I'm aware of where there's actually a leveraging of the donor contribution contributor to climate finance. So right now we're looking at this as a pilot, as an experiment. We hope it works. But we're looking at mobilizing and getting about $3 billion, $4 billion in guarantees. That should mobilize somewhere around $15 to $20 billion in climate finance. This is going to increase the headroom for ADB. We were talking about headroom this morning in some of the discussions. It'll increase our headroom, but it'll also put some ring-fence that money for climate finance.
Okay, so lots of topics for all that, right? Mitigation, adaptation, innovation, if that's being called. So we're getting together now. Where do you actually see innovation and finance happen on the ground?
Loaded question. Actually, so let me start with this. I'm an academic, right? So I have the luxury of sort of speaking in abstract terms. Let me try not to do that. And let me also add, so we know what I look like at 18 or so, 20 maybe. My wife has to wear glasses, so I've been confused with my students. I remember sitting at a panel like this, Copenhagen, 2009. Topic was innovative finance. One of the discussion points was headroom. And it was headroom in, you know, carbon emissions, so you can use the headroom developing countries have to lower their emissions further, save some money, spend it on the good stuff. It was COP15. What are we up to by now? 27 and a half, I believe. And you still, okay, so what gives? Well, here's the very practical. Despite my accent, originally from this country, spent quarter century now in the US. There is actually a bill or a law on the books. Three laws when you add them up: Inflation Reduction Act, bipartisan infrastructure law, CHIPS and Science. This is by investing in the US, not what the forum is all about. But the positive learning by doing spillovers, even sort of the most single-minded, macro But to, like, there's plenty of papers for me to write in peer-reviewed journals, and yes, I keep doing that, of course I will. What's the actual lesson?
Expenditure for the renewable less than
solar PV is cheaper than the year before, although the absolute price went up. Relatively speaking, solar PV is cheaper last year than it had ever been. In any year in the last, right? 40 years ago, when Jimmy Carter put the solar panels on the White House roof, 5 years later on, Reagan took them down, nobody's taking down solar panels anymore. Because it is the cheapest form of electricity in history.
But then when it's the cheapest form of electricity, you don't get the charges there, you don't get carbon credits when you utilize the solar panels. So,
but you don't need them, because it's the cheapest form of electricity in history.
But there are clearly other market failures at play if the economics point to 100 to 104 bucks goes with that.
Of course.
Look, I'm not an economist and I'm not disagreeing with the economics of this, but I, when I was at the bank, I ran our carbon finance operations with about $2.5 billion. And the price was not near the social cost of carbon, not anywhere near. But it did have an impact. And so I think we would, you know, certainly, I would love to see the social price of carbon be the price of carbon, but right now we don't have anything that's really solid. And so I would love
what I would watch out for is precisely these tiny little decisions that seem insignificant and make all the difference. Because, well, this is a race. It hopefully is a race to the top, overall, the positive sense of the term. And you don't have much more time to experiment, to get it wrong.
And a bit of finance, I speak. I will sum it up for
scale and speed.
But yes, more than a big old time is up. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for the very good job.
Thank you.
Somebody mentioned have the same conversation at the same time as Africa, and our women are discussing the same thing over and over, we're definitely going to be knocking the same door, and we're definitely going to get the same solution. But being expert, but it is a global challenge, and we are more than 50% of the global population, and we are actually people impacted, or if we're looking at who's impacted by climate change, women are more impacted than us statistically afar. So those who are more impacted should be closest to making the solution. So if we are to make the solutions, we need to have that to be on the agenda. And at your point, we are way off track on many, many of our SDGs and many of our targets. And when it comes to gender, we're definitely not even close to being on track. So back to your question. I think the beautiful thing about being the last panel is, you know, Dr. Mahmoud said a quote in Arabic, which is, I'm going to say another quote in Arabic, which is Hitam al-Mas. So when you end something, you end with, like, mask. So this is, we are ending that with basically the nicest, let's say, what works and what we need to do more to work for. So what works is international collaboration. That's very, very important. So international collaboration is key. Doubling and tripling renewable energy. And if you look at the latest statistics from Irina, we need to triple renewable energy. And there is already Irina is working with the UAE on a roadmap to make this happen by 2030. Ensuring that at the heart of the solution, we don't forget anybody. Nobody is left behind. So women, youth, and the global staff. This is extremely, extremely important. And the fourth, which is also something that we cannot emphasize enough, and I think we heard a few people speak about it. Energy transition is critical, but we are not all starting from the same place. So we definitely need to keep that in mind, because if we are going to have a just energy transition, that has to become with a very pragmatic approach that keeps in mind a roadmap for everybody, so nobody is left behind, and we do have a very just and looks into security in the same lens as energy access, because we still have millions, I think almost 700 million people still have zero access, and that's the real crisis when it comes to energy security and energy transition. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and I want to come back to that last point in our final round of discussion. The next speaker is the proverbial person who needs no introduction at this forum, Shaibal Ashaibi, as you undoubtedly all know, is Senior Director of Strategic Planning and Economic Services at the OPEC Fund. So over to you, Shaina, for your headlines on actionable solutions.
Thank you so much, Melinda, and welcome to all our guests. Thank you all for being here. So actually, I'd like to frame my conversation on the three points that Dr. Mahmoud has made. The first is that climate finance is development finance. We totally agree. As an organization that is deeply rooted in the South, the single global MDB that has a South-South mandate, we see climate change as the single most cross-cutting theme in all our sectors and all our projects. The need for climate finance is critical, and we fully embrace this through our climate action plan. More on this later. The second point he made is that global public goods need to stem from national platforms. We totally agree. We work across 125 countries at the Open Fund. And not only do we work at the national level, but also at the grassroots level, where our support to MSMEs, $500 million in the past 3 years alone, has accelerated enterprise and supported youth and women entrepreneurship. And the last point is that he made is that development banks, MDBs, need to be both bigger and better. We totally agree. As an institution that has built its business model on the fact that partnerships resonate and support impact and amplify it, we have partnered with most MDBs, philanthropies, NGOs, mostly everybody who is in this hall today, and this has really thrusted us forward. We're now looking into launching creative and inventive partnerships, last year we've launched the Climate Finance and Energy Innovation Hub, more on that later. But you see, we're totally focused on policies and partnerships that promote people and planet. Back to you, Lou.
Thank you so much, Shana. Wonderful. Let me go now to Kate Robertson. She's co-founder of the initiative One Young World, which brings together young leaders from across the planet, both as a network and as a summit. And its thousands of One Young World ambassadors have impacted the lives of millions of people. Over to you, Kate.
Thanks, Dave. Director General, thank you so much. Tara and Nadia, thank you so much. One Young World has had a partnership with the OPEC Fund for International Development from when we started until about, I think it was 2018, just before the pandemic, whereby they would help us to find young leaders across the developing world. Why young leaders? And I was talking to Dina earlier and saying, we're not working at One Young World with youth. We're working with young leaders. And I thought there was so much today, because so many of the people that are on this stage were leaders themselves, genuinely leaders, clearly leaders of impact. It's no good any single organization, certainly not one as small as ours, trying to do this alone. The collaboration required is absolutely serious. But here's the thing. Young people around the world today, the age group that we're working with, One Young World, which is 18 to 30, are the most informed, most educated, most connected generation in human history. They just are. That's just a fact. Old people like me may not like it, but it's a fact. They are the masters of the world that we are going to be living in, and certainly our children are living in that. So leadership from the side to give yourself shot in the head for a leader to emerge. So caring for those leaders is what we're about. It's intergenerational, and then completely with you. Completely with you. Climate mitigation of carbon emissions is number one focus, but they say to us as an organization, please measure everything, because the world doesn't care about us as young people. We go and we sit, not this institution, I'm glad to say, we sit at certain things where they put us on panels, young people are at the table, no one's listening to us, so it doesn't matter. So to be heard, please measure what we do. So we measure only 50 projects a year, where we have thousands of projects. But the 50 that we measure in the period since the pandemic have mitigated over 1 million tons of carbon. And we would measure all the projects and have millions in that number. But that's what we're working on. These people need every single one of you in this room. Real investment in the mitigation and adaptation projects we're engaged in. And many of them are not small. They're not little things where you can say, hey, have $1,000 and it's all going to be okay. We were joined in our efforts for 8 years by the late great Kofi Annan. For exactly the reasons we talked about today, I, with a brilliant professor who was on earlier from Colombia, I was with you at COP 2015 when we did Mr. Annan's campaign for COP. What a depressing time that was. I keep telling myself that with the support of the fund and everybody else here, maybe it's not as bad as 2015. I think it's worse, but I just keep telling myself it's going to be okay. Thank you very much, Kate. And finally, over to Jan Eagle, who is Director General of the International Development Law Organization. And she has had a 40-year career in multilateral.
We devoted to promoting the rule of law for a purpose for advanced peace and sustainable development, and we particularly focused on people-centered justice. And I'm very proud that OPEC is a member party of IDLO. I wanted just to focus on three areas that we think is essential for actionable results, and they really build on the other things that they produce. We have to empower vulnerable people. In the case of climate, we must empower
Thank you very much for that, for putting a lot of content and meaning into the term rule of law, which we so often use, but which sometimes sounds a little sterile. So many thanks for that. Let us now move on into policies and partnerships for climate and environment, and then we'll come back to resilience at the close. So, Noah, you talked about the need to dramatically scale up action on renewables. Certainly that is a main focus also of Irina's new world energy transition outlook. And tell us a little bit about what you see as the most promising policies for doing that. What can we do to boost this at the kind of scale that you're talking about?
Well, let me start by thanking Your Excellency and the OPEC Fund for partnering on the ETA, which is the Energy Transition Accelerator Finance Platform. And that's a very important platform because it aims to, by 2030, hopefully reach 5 gigawatts of renewables. That's going to be basically targeting these developed countries and cities. And this contribution is extremely important because it shows that renewables now, and we heard it throughout the speeches, makes commercial sense. Because it is important for development, but also one of the cheapest sources of energy. And we've seen that the UAE has 3 of the largest, cheapest solar power plants in the world. So for us to reach the scale that we need international cooperation. We need mobilizing fund, but we need projects that are attractive to global investors. And we see that once you have those together, you have a trusted partner, because trust is very important, like I mean, a big fund than others, then, you know, magic happens. Because once you mobilize capital, and which is also extremely important, and I don't think we've heard enough about it today, the political will and the political leadership to make this happen, then we will see that mobilizing very quickly. And with Irina, the work that we do is we, you know, educating and ensuring that, you know, we are sharing best practice with different member state countries, we are actually connecting them with investment opportunities and investment platforms, and providing the enabling environment for those investments. So you mentioned that we need to have clear examples. ETA is one important example. Today, ETA is more than $1 billion with the generous contribution of the fund now. And we have the Public Lives and Livelihood, which is another initiative that's going to reach $1 billion to, as the name of the initiative is, the Power Lives and Livelihood through climate solutions that's focusing on health and agri-food and agriculture, and many, many other examples that, you know, partnership between the UAE and Irina, other member states and Irina that is happening in many countries using innovative technology solutions such as technology that has very much environmental sensitive to certain regions, for example, the folding wind turbines, and using innovative solutions, financial solutions, and ensuring that we are mobilizing enough political will to make those projects happen on our side.
Thank you very much. And I'll go straight over to Noel, if I may, to also talk, Shaina, to also talk about, to also talk about policies that you think are key for for prioritizing action on climate. And you mentioned the climate impact facility in particular, so maybe you could tell us a bit more about that.
So thank you. Yes, so, you know, our climate finance, which as I said is the single most important cross-cutting theme of all, is determined by our climate action plan. And let me just share with you briefly what that is. The climate action plan commits us to increasing our climate financing to 40% of all our operations by
in the Arab Coordination Group, heads of institutions, and together we announced joint climate action of $24 billion. This governs all our institutions' support for climate work. So let me go back to policy, how we support policy as the OPEC Fund. In the past 3 years ago, we approved policy and program loans totaling $1.2 billion to support enabling climate policies in partner countries. Policies that drive both inclusive growth as well as energy transition, and therefore a win-win for development and climate outcomes. Two examples of these, which do exactly that, are Colombia's Climate Action and Energy Transition Program, where we supported this for $150 million, as well as support to the economic resilience and green recovery in Botswana, for example. Many more examples exist. We're also intensifying our efforts to deliver our climate financing through transformational projects that actually do help flatten the emission curve. We are contributing to the acceleration of energy transition, and as Dr. Nawal has mentioned, through partnerships with the likes of IRENA. And here really, to Dr. Nawal, I'd really like to thank the UAE's leadership role. IRENA is not only putting in bulk of finance that is scalable, but it's also been tackling complex, dynamic problems in a pointed, well-informed, and attentive manner. So thank you very much, Dr. Nawal, for your support. Going forward, we also intend to play a catalytic role in biodiversity conservation. We're currently exploring collaboration with the Asian Development Bank, one of our greatest partners, to set up the first nature-focused financing hubs for the Asian Pacific region. We're also discussing that with the Arab Coordination Group, and hopefully this will come to fruition sometime soon. So as you can see, again, policies and partnerships that really do conserve the planet. Thank you.
And I think your emphasis on capacity building in the policy area is very, very interesting, because, of course, that's part of political will, isn't it? For leaders to exercise political will, they absolutely do need to have the tools of the trade, and I think that emphasis is key in what you're doing. So thank you very much for that. Let me go over to Kate to talk again about young people in this context also of action for the planet, because, of course, they are the important stakeholders in the future, health of the planet. So what policies and practices are proving really effective and empowering them to be part of setting these transformative policy solutions going forward? How do you bring them in as leaders?
Well, at the moment, it's this, isn't it? Really. I mean, we listened to what you were saying about the UAE, which is amazing. And there are clearly governments in the room who are doing things that are amazing. You know, and I know, in the industrialized West, particularly in the democracies, God help me, I didn't think I would ever say this, leadership is weak and pathetic when it comes to setting policies regarding this crisis. That is just a fact. And if any of us think that young people don't see that, we're fools. They see it, and they actually, as that young professor was saying, they really can't believe it. So what policies are they looking for? They're looking for the policies that everybody here today has actually set up. Everybody that was on the stage today set up a target and said, it should be like that. So all of this stuff about the enabling, right from the beginning where they were saying, I think it was Stephanie's session, the G7 regulatory framework isn't there to enable you to do all the things that you need to do. So we're sitting here, we're applauding certain countries, UAE being one of them, where the policies are there. But here we're sitting with the law. Where are the laws that enables us to do what we need to do about climate change? It's really straightforward. That has to come from governments. It comes from leadership in governments. And there's not a lot of it about.
Thank you very much. And I think, Jan, I'd like to ask you to build on that. Nawal and I were having a conversation earlier, kind of a nerdy SDG-type conversation about which SDGs we like best. Well, number 16 is definitely probably my favorite, maybe because I'm the lawyer.
You know, Kate was talking earlier about measuring things. Well, measuring is the beginning, but it's certainly not the end of accountability and compliance. So talk to us a little bit about that.
I think that we would agree that SDG 16 is not only important in its own right to peaceful, just, and resilient societies, but it's an enabler, hopefully, for all of the other SDGs. And what we would say is that you want to look at policies that they're going to be effective through a people-centered lens and through a human rights lens. You've got, as I said earlier, to involve the people concerned. It only works if those who are affected are part of the decision-making. And just give one quick example, for example, we have supported the government of Kenya, which enacted in 2016 the first federal climate change law in Africa, and that was to give effect to a provision in the constitution some years before on the right to a clean environment. But what did that mean? And in order to make it actually happen, there was very broad consultations to ensure that the type of law that was put in place was fair and inclusive. We've also got to look at ways to handle climate-related disputes before they escalate into mass movements of people, conflict, loss of livelihoods, and distrust, again, more distrust between people and central institutions. And here we've got, again, to look at different types of institutions, and particularly we're looking a lot at alternative dispute resolution in helping many different countries at different levels of development or with different legal systems to bring in alternative dispute resolution centers, and also to empower indigenous people, because they also need to know their rights and to be participating in decisions and making. And the last thing I would say is that I do believe, as many have seen today, that South-South cooperation is key. There are many excellent examples in the South that we can share. That's one of the things that we are trying to do at IDLO, to find good examples. And of course, global context is always important. But how can we use those examples from the South to help others move forward?
Thank you very much. And I want to switch now to focus on resilience and people, but maybe I'm going to do it with a bridge that essentially you just helped me to build. Not too long ago, I was moderating at a conference that was about early warning systems for climate stress and what they could tell us about likely conflict and or migration. We had scientists from all over the world present there at this conference, and the organizers thought that they were going to hear a lot about indicators, rainfall, drought, and so on, and that would perhaps help them to come up with better algorithms. But scientist after scientist, from Latin America, from Africa, really from all around the world, said, you know what is the most important indicator that we see? It's not the amount of rain that falls, it's who it falls on. How resilient is this society? How inclusive is it? We look at where are the women and children in this society, and that's how we know what is likely to happen if they face climate stress, because the more inclusive, the better they can cope. That's the definition of resilience. So I'd like to ask all of you in this closing round to talk about what you see as key to boosting inclusion, gender, young people, about marginalized groups, what you think is key, and how we all can collaborate to work together toward that end for people. So please, Nabon.
It's definitely not only a key. I think it's the only way for us to move forward. And that's why, if I may really speak about one example, I was speaking about the COP28. So just quickly, just give you some statistics. So for COP28, we have three members of the presidency. Two of them are women. So we have Fürstengasse, supported by her excellency, looking at the closer, we have for the first time ever youth climate champion, and we can, that shows how much we are focusing on mitigation in the climate talks. Until today, we have the COP28 team has more women than men, so 50% more women, 50% plus women in the team. We have more than 40 nationalities, with over 60% representing G77 countries, and the age is, the median age is 36. So what we see, and why those statistics are important to flag, is what we see, it reflects the diversity of today's population, and hence the solutions that we need to identify, how we need to have a cross-cutting technologies and solutions. doing that through policy support, capacity building, project bankability, and de-risking tools. And using all of these as levers to accelerate private capital flow, enterprises that support women and youth. This year, just yesterday, we've also signed a partnership agreement with the World Food Programme. We intend to replicate the same system, but not for energy transition, for what Dr. Joshoff today said, for the agriculture sector transition, with huge focus on small older farmers that are most vulnerable to the impacts of climate change, with a special focus on women through capacity building to help reduce the gender productivity gap. More and more, we're working with our partners, a lot of them again in this room, in order to be able to deliver policies that really do support the most vulnerable. Going forward to COP28, we're actually in discussions to explore new partnerships to create brand new financial ecosystems that understand, value, promote, and provide financial platforms that can nurture the business ventures of youth and women at scale. So we know that one thing is clear for us is that we're all in this together, and through excellent partnerships like we have in this room and elsewhere, we can deliver partnerships and policies that really do support the people. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Basically, to address climate change. It's absolutely essential that we build those resilient societies. And so I would ask those of you who have the possibility to think about investing in the rule of law. A relatively small investment can, I think, pay very large dividends. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I think if there's one thing that can be said about this confluence of crises on the upside, it is that it has focused attention on resilience as few times beforehand. So I think positive action can hopefully proceed from the fact that we at least now look at resilience much more closely than we did before. Dear women leaders on this panel, many, many thanks for sharing your insights and your perspectives and for helping us to end this closing conversation on, I think, a very inspiring note. There is obviously a huge amount of work to be done, but you've given us a sense, I think, of where we need to be going and of hope. So thank you very much for that.
Now the conference was finished and lots of enjoy today, and all the best my all friends. Please like and subscribe to my channel. Take care. We will meet for my next video. Bye bye.